Good morning, church. Stand to your feet and sing with us. Welcome to the Water's Edge. The faithful are here. Come on, let's worship our King this morning.
This dry and desert land,
I tell myself,
keep walking on.
Here's something up ahead.
Here's something up ahead. Water falling like a song.
Oh, this track is all obvious.
One,
there we go.
Four.
An everlasting stream, your river carries me home. Let it flow, let it flow.
Edge, y'all. Hey, we filled out pretty nice in here. All right, it's good to notice. I'm taking attendance right now. The strong ones are here. All right. Thanks for coming to the Water's Edge on this glorious day. Glad the rain kind of subsided. When I got out of my car this morning, it was like small ice bullets just hitting me in the face. And it's nice to be here. The sun out, the sun is shining. Hey, the Tigers won a big game on Friday, and it was my first high school football game I ever went to. And I walked into almost a pick six by our Watertown Tigers. So next week is a big game. And it's good to note that since the Water's Edge people have been doing the concessions, we've been winning a whole lot. It reminds me of a story in the Old Testament when they used to carry the Ark of the Covenant into battle. When we carry those fried catfish sandwiches into battle, the Lord comes through. And there's something to that, okay? All right, that's theology. That's enough theology for today. This Wednesday, we're meeting for the youth, and this will be our last Wednesday before Thanksgiving. So Wednesday the 25th, we won't be having youth. But this Wednesday, come on out. We're going to have a feast of our own or something. Not sure what we're doing yet, but it's going to be fun. All right, other announcements. What else is going on around here? Today, you came on a good Sunday. Sam Fiesel, the Honduran missionary, is about to share his whole story. And I don't think we've ever heard that here at the Water's Edge on a Sunday service, so I'm excited for that. And take a minute, say hi to someone around you, shake their hand, give them a hug, whatever you want to do. And we're going to sing one more song after that. Give you guys about a minute. Come on, get friendly.
Yeah!
things new. You are making all things new. You are making all things new. We are free.
Thank you, Jesus, for the freedom we find in you. You take what's old and you restore it, and you bring new life into it. You breathe your life into it, God, and we need that more than ever. Maybe we don't. Maybe we need it like this all the time, God. We just don't know it. I pray that you give us that life, that fresh breath, Lord, that new perspective. Help us see things the way you do, not to live life in fear. But you know what's going on. You hold the whole world in your hands. Not a God out of control, but one that's got more purpose than we could ever dream up in our brains. You love us, God, and we love you. So speak something new to us. Pray that you'd use Sam and his story just to touch our hearts, to breathe some empathy into our hearts for the ones in this world that are really hurting, that don't have some of the basic stuff that they need to live. So bless Sam. I pray that you give him a double portion of your blessing as he sings to us, speaks that story, and that it would touch us. We love you. We know that you're going to do all these things because you're faithful. We pray this in your son's name. Amen. Amen. Y'all can have a seat. And Pastor TJ.
Well, before he comes out here, one of the things that we have started here at Water's Edge, and we really believe in giving to missions, and we really believe in kind of giving to the next generation. And one of the things, even though we're small and even though we're new, and Sam came to me not too long ago and asked if we would kind of be kind of the sending church for them. And I'm not sure if I've ever told him this. Come on out here, Sam. But as a church, our leadership team and myself, we have decided that we want to put our money where our mouth is, and we want to give you $1,000 a month from the Water's Edge. Because you guys have been so faithful in giving, it allows us to do that. Okay, and so it's been a really tough year for my friend here, but he knows that I would not be pastoring this church if not for his encouragement. Met Sam, I guess, about right before he started. We met, and he said he was going to come and help us get started, and he's even rode some buggies and set up some signs and all that kind of good stuff, and I'm excited not only to hear him speak, but you guys are going to be blessed because he's going to actually sing a song for us. I love you, my man.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee, and thou changest not. Thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Tu fidelidad, tu fidelidad, cada momento la veo in me. Y nada me falta, pues, todo provees, grande Señor es tu fidelidad. Great is thy faithfulness, great is your faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. And all I have needed, all I have needed, you see, all I have needed, your hand has provided. Great is your faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Peggy, I need my order of service that you stole from me, please. That would be nice to have right up here. Well, it is so exciting to be sharing at home. For the last 6 weeks, Peggy and I have been on the road, and we have been going and sharing at different churches and sharing at different places all over the place. And, you know, like last week we were in Kentucky in the morning service. Thank you, brother. Kentucky in the morning service, and drove to Memphis and did the night service and then came back. It was crazy. So we're excited to be home. Do you know how it feels after a long day of work and you sit in your recliner? It's like, that's what it's like to come home. So I've been excited to be able to share my story with you. And people always ask me, how did a guy from Wilson County, how did just an average church guy from Wilson County, from Gladeville Baptist Church down the road, how did he end up serving for almost 20 years as an international missionary, founding a mission agency? How did that happen? Well, I want to tell you my story and how God took me from a church member just like you guys, just like we were, into this calling that's on our life. But you see, I don't want to tell my story because I cannot tell my story without sharing his story. Guys.
If I told you my story, you would hear hope that wouldn't let go. And if I told you my story, you would hear love that never gave up.
Stories.
praising my Savior all the day long.
Our story begins with a beautiful wife that sits back in the back. She kind of runs everything of the ministry behind the scenes. And I could not do what I do without Peggy beside me. And sorry to get emotional, but it's hard to get up here and talk about our story without talking about the 35 years that Peggy has been by my side. And it's pretty exciting to do life and to do ministry with Peggy in this journey. And we are blessed to have 3 children. When we moved to Honduras, our oldest was about 12, and his name is Peyton. If you want to put that picture up there, there's our family. And actually, they are all here with us today. If you're in my family, would you stand up, please? Sweet. All right. So anyway, back in the saddle. So we are so blessed to have 3 children to go with us on this journey, this crazy journey. But where the journey started was way back in 2000. I was not working as a nurse, but I had worked as a nurse. And so we had a group of people come up and say, "Hey, Sam, we're doing a medical mission trip to Honduras. We would love for you to come to Honduras with us and work as a nurse." And I thought, wow, that would be so cool. I mean, I could go and I could sit across the table and I could use my medical training and I could look in their eyes and I could be the hands and feet of Jesus to all these people. It's going to be awesome. So I pay my money. I get on the plane. I head down there. I was on a team of 72 people on this trip. So when we got to Honduras, we didn't have enough translators and we had too many doctors and nurses. And so they said, "Brother Sam," because you know we're Baptist, "Brother Sam, we need you to work in the pharmacy." I said, "In the pharmacy?" And they said, "Yeah, we need somebody in the pharmacy who has medical background." Blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, okay. So my first day in the pharmacy, I'm like, okay, I'm going to work in the pharmacy. So the first day in the pharmacy, my work consisted of this. I walk over here, and I get a bag of Tylenol, and I put it in the bag. And I walk over here, and I give it to somebody who speaks Spanish so they can give it to the people in need. So I wasn't even looking in their face. I was not even anywhere near a Honduran. And I had paid all this money to go, and I was going to try to use my medical training. And I was just really very frustrated. So the next morning, Tuesday morning, I get up, and I go, and I sit in my camping chair, and I have my wonderful little Honduran coffee sitting there, and the roosters are crowing, and the donkeys are braying, and all that kind of stuff that they do. And I'm sitting there, and I'm like, "God, you know, why did you bring me here? Why am I here? Why did I pay this money? I was just really a frustrated brat, to be honest. I was just really frustrated, and I was like acting like a spoiled brat is what I was doing. And I sit there, and I said, "Okay, God, just tell me why I'm here." So my Bible opened up. Now, children, you don't talk when Papa's talking. I'm just kidding. You just talk all you want, it, baby. You just talk all you want. Anyway, my Bible opens up to a scripture that I had read all of my life. I've been in church all my life, taught Sunday school for years. And it opened up to a scripture, Jeremiah 29:11. And it says, "I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. If you will seek me with all of your heart, I will be found by you." And I said, "Okay, God, I hear you loud and clear. I got it. If I will seek you with all of my heart, you will be found by me. Okay, God, I'm seeking you today. I'm seeking you with all my heart. You tell me, why am I in this super hot, dusty, dry, miserable country called Honduras? Why am I here and why did you have me come here?" So I go about my business. I'm working in the pharmacy. We've got 400 people outside our window trying to get their little free bag of Tylenol and vitamins. We're sweating. It's hot. I mean, there's people everywhere. It's total chaos. And just about that time, I get my bag of Tylenol and I go to hand it to the door to give to the translator. And I look and all the people separated and they parted like the Red Sea. And on a bench right outside the pharmacy, there was an old woman. And she was sitting there and she was dirty. And she had her hair pulled back in a bun. And she was probably, she looked like she was about 85, but I would say she was probably 65. But she was weathered and dirty. She didn't have any shoes on. And she was just sitting there. She was just patiently waiting for her free little bag of Tylenol. And I sit there and I looked at that lady and I thought, God, what kind of life has this woman had? She has probably raised 10 children on a turnip patch. She has had to scrape and scrounge for firewood every day of her life to build a fire to make tortillas for her children. Her husband left her probably 10 years ago, and she's had to do everything. I mean, she was so tired. And just about that minute, a little girl, schoolgirl, came and sat down right beside her. And she had on her little blue school uniform, her little dirty white shirt. She had on some flip-flops. Her hair was pulled back in a ponytail. And she had been playing on the playground. And she was sitting there, and she was waiting on her little bag of Tylenol. And I sat there, and I looked at that little girl. And I looked at that old woman. And I just kept going back and forth, back and forth. And God told me in my spirit, as clear as I can tell you, Sam, if you don't do something for that little girl, she is going to become that old woman without the hope of a Savior, without the assurance of salvation, without the love of Christ in her life. Can I go and fix every single solitary problem that that old lady has? Absolutely not. I cannot. But what I can do is I can give hope to the hopeless. That is what God has called me to do. So I'm sitting there and I'm looking at this and I'm getting all emotional and all the crowd starts to pull back in and everything was over. And this whole scenario, the old woman, little girl scenario, just poof, was gone just that fast. So the next morning, I get up, I go and I get my camping chair and I get my Honduran coffee and those same roosters were crowing and the same donkeys were braying. And I'm sitting there and I'm like, God, what does that mean? What does it mean that, you know, this old lady and this young girl, and if I don't do something, I know, God, you must want me to give to missions. You want me to give some money to missions and I can support a missionary that's over there doing that. Or maybe, I know, you want me to lead a team to come down to Honduras to help the old ladies. That's what you want me to do. And at that minute, I said, God, show me in your word. I have shared several of these stories with my men's group on Monday night that meet, and they're kind of getting accustomed to these kind of stories. But I said, God, you show me in your word what you want me to do. And my Bible opened up to a verse I had never ever in all of my years of being a Christian and teaching in church and being in church, I'd never, ever, ever read the scripture before. And it's in Isaiah 58:10-11. And it says, if you spend yourself on behalf of the hungry and you satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness and your night will become like noonday. The Lord will guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land. He will strengthen your frame. You will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. Well, as I read that, when I used to teach teenagers, I would put their name in the scripture for it to make more sense. So I would say, for God so loved Heather, that he gave his only begotten son, so Heather. And I would put the name in there to give it relevance. So I did the same thing with me. I said, Sam, if you will spend yourself on behalf of the hungry, and you will satisfy the needs of the oppressed. Then, Sam, your light will rise in the darkness, and your night will become like noonday. I will guide you always. I will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land. I will strengthen your frame. And you know, the reason that I open all of my presentations with "Great is thy faithfulness" is because there's nothing I can do any more important than to share with you the faithfulness of God in my life and in my ministry and in my family. Well, I knew immediately that God was calling me to be a missionary. But I had one simple problem at that point. Peggy was still over here in Gladeville, and she had three little kids. She didn't make the trip. The kids didn't make the trip. I was by myself. So she is back here homeschooling three kids, and I'm over in Honduras feeling the calling, you know, feeling the calling on my life over here in Honduras, and she's over there. So I'm thinking, oh, my goodness, how am I going to have this conversation? You know, how am I going to say, Peggy, what do you think? Do you like Taco Bell? What do you think about tortillas? I mean, are you know, what about mi ranchita? How are you all about some mi ranchita? Well, I didn't know how that conversation was going to go. So I come back from Honduras, and the first opportunity that I had for us to sit down and talk serious, she said, oh, Sam, listen, I want to hear all about your trip. I want to hear everything. I was praying for you, and I just want to hear everything. And I said, Lord, give me strength. How is this going to go down? How is this going to happen, you know? And I said, well, Peggy, now I've got this big knot in my throat. I said, Tuesday morning, I got up, and I had the coolest quiet time. She goes, I did too. She said, I had the best quiet time Tuesday morning. And I said, okay, honey, great. Okay, well, I'll tell you what. You go ahead and give me all of the information about your little quiet time, because I'm about to drop the mother load right here, right now. That's what I wanted to say. So she said, okay, well, I'll tell you, I got up, and I was praying for you, and I was praying for the team and for your safety and travels, and that God would be revealed to everybody. And she said, Sam, my Bible, I got my Bible, and it opened up to Jeremiah 29:11. And, yeah, my mouth about fell open. And she said, do you know the scripture? I said, oh, yeah, I know the scripture. She said, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, da, 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 da. And she said, Sam, God told me that he was going to do something very special with our family and for me to be faithful to the calling that God has on our life. Is that unbelievable? Is it just like God to upstage my big announcement? You know, I mean, it was so incredible. And I said, honey, I know that scripture. And the last part of that verse says, if we will seek him with all of our heart, he will be found by us. And you know what? Another verse that God gave me on Wednesday morning was, Peggy, if we spend ourselves on behalf of the hungry and we satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then our light will rise in the darkness and our night will become like noonday. Well, at that point, everything was all about logistics. You know, it was all about coming back and being approved by the board of directors. We worked for 5 years with a ministry called Baptist Medical Dental Mission International, and they are just amazing at what they do, which is evangelism and medical teams. They're the best. So I had a great 5 years of training with that ministry. And so we sold our house. We lived over here off Stewart's Ferry. Sold our house, put everything in storage, you know, packed everything up, raised our money, and we headed off to Honduras and to Costa Rica for a year and then on to Honduras. And so our children, our three children, had quite the adventure. They had to give up Little League. They had to give up T-ball. They had to give up a lot of things that most kids do not have to give up to be able to do what we did. And, you know, our two younger kids, it was just all a big adventure. Oh, we're going to fly on a plane. We're going to see monkeys. And it's going to be so exciting. All this stuff. Well, our oldest kind of knew the gravity of the situation. And he knew that, you know what? We're leaving all of our friends. Everybody that we know, we're leaving. And it was a little more weighted on him than it was on the other two. Well, after about 2 or 3 weeks into it, Morgan, our daughter, comes to me and says, okay, Dad, I think I'm ready to go home. I said, honey, we are home. This is home. This little concrete box in a little concrete neighborhood in Costa Rica is our home. We don't live in beautiful Middle Tennessee anymore. This is where we live. It was very difficult that Satan loves to get in the middle of your business when you're in this time. And Satan loves to tell you, you know what? You're too old. You're 40 years old. You can't learn a new language at 40. You're stupid. He's doing it much better than you are. He's much smarter than you are. Oh, wait, he does, but he sings better than they do better. Satan loves to attack you in that. Well, God gave us Matthew 28:18 as the cornerstone. And that verse says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I've commanded you, and lo, I am with you to the end of the age. You know, when Jesus was just about to leave earth, he had already been resurrected. He was just about to ascend to the Father. The last thing that he said to us. You know, I always tell people, it's kind of like those of you who have kids go off to college. You know, Kevin. Kids go off to college where, you know, as they're driving off, you want to say, check the oil. Don't forget to, you know, those last things are the most important things. Well, that's exactly what Jesus did. Jesus said, go and make disciples. And in making disciples, you will win the world. Well, we worked with Baptist Medical Dental for 5 years. And after those 5 years, we quickly realized that we were doing a lot of evangelism, but we were not doing a lot of making disciples. We were going, and I was singing every night in evangelism services, and people were accepting Christ, and we would have 25, 35, 45, 50 people come to receive Christ, and it was wonderful. But what was happening Monday after that team left? They were being lost, and they were going back into the woods, and they were just being lost. So God called us to resign our mission and to start Ignite Missions. Well, I was at the point, I knew that God wanted me to do more discipleship. So I went to the president of Baptist Medical Dental Mission, and I said, listen, I really feel like we're missing the boat here. We're doing a great job of medical clinics. We're doing a great job of doing evangelism. I mean, all that stuff is awesome. But I feel like we're missing the boat. And I thought, you know what? I'm willing to take on this project of adding the discipleship piece to all of these places. And they said, well, I tell you what, this is how we do things. So let me know Thursday by 2 if you're going to be with us or not. And so I said, okay, God, well, I know that I'm probably not going to continue in a ministry that God has told me something different. So God, if you want me to go back to Tennessee, I mean, I'll go back and be a greeter at Walmart. I don't know what. I mean, I'll go do something, but I'll be a missions minister somewhere. And God gave me a scripture, and it's 2 Timothy 1:6-7. And it says, fan into flame the gifts I've given you through the laying on of hands, for God did not give us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of self-discipline. And what that verse said to me, I read it, and I had read that before, and I was on the floor, and I was crying out to God, and I said, God, give me some direction. If you want me to go back to Tennessee, I'm fine with it. I'm fine. I'm cool. If you want me to stay here in Honduras with this other ministry and do discipleship, I'm fine. But you have to tell me what I'm doing. And I got up and I got that scripture. God gave me that scripture. And I looked in the the column of my Ryrie Study Bible, and it said this, no lie. It said, Timothy was a missionary in a foreign land. Paul was writing a letter to Timothy to tell him to stay the course, to continue doing what God had called him to do, to continue to what he brought to the table, to continue with power and with love and with self-discipline. And I said, I'm the Timothy. That's me. God is saying, Sam, you bring certain skills to the table. You can do certain things. There's things you don't do very well, but you can do certain things, and you can do it and continue doing that. And I said, wow, fan into flame the gifts of how poetic. Fan into flame. And I'm like, that is exactly what God wants me and Peggy to do. He wants us to go to these villages. He wants us to fan into flame. He wants us to ignite. That morning, Ignite Missions was born. And I got off that floor and I said, God, give me direction. He not only gave me direction, he not only gave me a scripture to base our ministry, but he gave me a name of our ministry. That was in January of 2008. We left BMDMI, we came back to Tennessee, we're incorporated in the state of Tennessee. We started our process of acquiring a 501c3, and the journey began. We went back, we talked to all our supporters, and pretty much everybody stayed with us except for you know, a couple of people, and they were basically giving to BMDMI. They weren't really giving to us, so I expected to lose them. But for all intents and purposes, everybody was coming with us to start this new ministry. So we started our ministry, and honestly, if I could tell you, it was me and Peggy and an igloo cooler and three kids. That was our ministry. We had nothing. Everything belonged to the other ministry. So we started that first year, and we had one team of North Americans come down. Woohoo! We were fired up. We had 65 professions of faith. We were storming hell with a water pistol. We were fired up. And so that first year, we celebrated what God was doing through Ignite Missions. And then the next year, we had three teams. And the next year, we had nine teams. And the next year, we had 17 teams. And the next year, we had 24 teams. And the next year, we had 30 teams. So we exploded in growth. Exploded. And I'm telling you, as the only missionary at the time, it was killing us. It was killing us. So what I want to do is, right now, I want to show you a video of our ministry. And just to kind of brag out and do a little couple of kudos or whatever, my son Parker, sitting right over here, has done a lot of the video work for the bridge in Lebanon, and he's done some here with the Atoma weekends and all those kinds of things. The Easter weekend that was at the fairgrounds, he did all the video stuff for that. And then he also produced this video that you're about to see. And so it is... Okay. It was a good video, don't you think? That was a nice video. Good job, Parker. No. Anyway, and so I was about to say, it's really, really a blessing to have a videographer in the family. So now you can run the video.
Oh.
Pretty cool video. I don't know about you, but that makes me tired just watching it, because every one of those pictures is a story of our struggle that we had. But it's just amazing what God has done and done in Honduras through Ignite Missions. And it's definitely not me, and it's not Peggy, and it's what God has done. I want to, if in the video you probably saw a really pretty young lady, and that pretty young lady is my daughter Morgan. Stand up, Morgan, with two babies, if you could. There she is. Okay, that's our daughter, Morgan. And Morgan left the mission field, and she decided to come back to Middle Tennessee, and she went to cosmetology school, and she was working, and she just felt like that she was not where God wanted her. And so she said, "Dad, do you think maybe I could come back to Honduras, and I could work the team season with you this year?" And I said, "Well, yeah, because you're bilingual and you can speak Spanish and I won't have to pay a translator." "Yeah, sure." So Morgan says, "Okay, well, I'll come and I'll work teams and I'll translate for you." And I said, "Okay, cool." Well, I also received another phone call, and there was a team member from a team from North Carolina, and his name was Coy Davis. And Coy called me and he said, "Sam, I came down on a mission trip and I just can't get Honduras out of my heart. I just can't." And he said, "I've figured things out enough financially that I could probably come and spend 6 or 8 months. Do you think it'd be possible for me to come down and help you with teams?" And I said, "Well, yeah, sure." So all of a sudden, I've got Morgan on this side of the house, who is a beautiful young girl. And I've got Coy over here, who's living in this side of the house. And he's single and wanting to be a missionary. And so as you know, the Lord would orchestrate things. The two of them fell in love under my roof. And so they surrendered to full-time missions. And Coy is an amazing contractor for construction. He can do pretty much anything that comes. And God knew that we were going into a big construction project, and God brought him to help us. Morgan has a heart for ladies' ministry. And she is a great teacher and discipler of women, and she and Peggy go and they do women's ministry together. Her number one job, obviously, is to be a mama, and she has a 3-year-old son and a 2-year-old daughter, and her job is to be mama to them. But when she has time, she goes out and she does women's ministry and women's conferences, and she teaches women how to crochet, and they make jewelry so they can sell it to support their family. And it's just a beautiful, beautiful ministry. And I wanted to mention Morgan and Coy to you. They're a huge, huge blessing to us. And not only that, they have two of our grandbabies, and two of our grandbabies live in Honduras, and two of our grandbabies live here. So when we're here, we see these two. When we're there, we see those two. And so God worked it out that this Gigi and Papa can get their grandbaby feel at any time. So that's awesome. God has allowed us to start 5 churches. So just like the Water's Edge, we have 5 of these. Okay, and they're Ignite Mission churches. We have purchased land. We have built buildings. We have 5 pastors that go out week in and week out and share the good news of Jesus Christ. And the reason I did that, the reason we worked so hard to do that, is because one day, and I know you can imagine this, one day I'm going to be too old to do this. And I'm going to have to take my cane and leave, and I'm going to have to leave Honduras. But you know what? As long as I have these churches in place, the good news of Jesus Christ and the Word of God is going to be preached, and it's going to be continually preached week in and week out, week in and week out, if Sam is there or not. So, you know, this makes it bigger than you are. So that is the heartbeat for going and sharing the gospel in these communities. And we have those 5 pastors. Well, let me tell you, the 5 pastors, those 5 men, are the poorest people in the village. And you say, "Well, why are they so poor?" Because we can go in our churches and we can preach tithing all day long. But 10% of nothing is nothing. So there's no money coming in. So part of what we do is we share with them, "Listen, hey, you know, you've got 10 chickens. Give the pastor a chicken. Give him a chicken. Just give him a chicken. Okay? You've got a couple of dozen eggs. Give him a dozen eggs. You just killed a hog. Give him some bacon." That's how you can support your pastor. And so when we take on a pastor, we take on the financial responsibility of them, their family, their children, their health care, their shoes, their school books, their backpacks. We take on everything. So it is financially a huge undertaking to take on a church and a pastor, just because they're not going to get any support from the church, or very little support from the church. Well, this year, back up. We had the blessing of being able to purchase 26 acres of land on top of a mountain. And it is absolutely the most beautiful piece of property that I've seen in Honduras. Of course, I'm kind of partial, but it has got this Gatlinburg kind of view up there, and it's literally on the summit of a mountain, and we are in the process of building 10 buildings. Four dorms, a dining hall, a mission house, a storage building, Coy and Morgan's house, mine and Peggy's house, and those are the 10 buildings. Well, we have presently built the storage building, the dining hall, kitchen, and two dorms. So it is open for business. Now, if you went to Honduras from the bridge or from Water's Edge, stand up. Stand up. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of the guys are in this service. Thank you, guys. Listen, give them a round of applause, everybody. These guys, they worked themselves to death. I'm just telling you. Pastor TJ, bless his heart, I'm telling you, he was toe up from the flow up. But they put down tile in every one of the buildings, including 6 showers, and toilets. It's just, the work they did was unbelievable. And we had such a wonderful time. And so this is our project out here. It is huge, but God has given us this project. And when we get a little bit of money, we build a building. We get a little bit of money, we do this. We fix that. We do this. We don't have big, deep pockets. We're just that little poor little mission down there. We live on offerings just like the Water's Edge lives on offerings. And when God has been faithful to us and when we get some money, then we do something. And we do something with it. So we're about halfway done on our property. As many of you know, COVID has hurt all of us. It's hurt this church, it's hurt our community, it's hurt our government, it's hurt our elections, it's hurt everything. Well, it has done its number on Honduras as well. And, you know, when they say, well, hey, little Carson, when they say Wilson County was shut down, they don't know what shut down is. Honduras shut down. And when I say shut down, meaning the roads were closed, there were barricades on the road. You were allowed one day to go to a grocery store every 2 weeks. So depending on the number on your ID, you could go to the barricade and you could say, look, I'm a number 6. Today is Wednesday. I can be on the road. And you can show them your number. And they allow you to go to the grocery store, to the pharmacy, or to the gas station. That's it. Nothing else. If you need to see a lawyer, too bad. If you need to go to the mall and buy a shirt, too bad. If you need to go get your oil changed, too bad. It shut down. The reason it did is because the healthcare system in Honduras is so weak and fragile that if we had an outbreak like we do in the States, there's only 6 ventilators in the whole country. The whole country of Honduras. And there's like 10 million people with 6 ventilators. So if it got really, really bad, we would lose hundreds of thousands of people to COVID. So they shut the country down. So when saying they shut the country down, which means all the public transportation, all the transportation for the poor was over. So all the people up in the mountains where we live, all of those people, they may have, if they were blessed enough to have 10 acres of corn that they could go sell, they couldn't bring it to market. They could go pick the corn and it would rot because they couldn't get, if they were blessed enough to have some corn and this guy over here has some green beans, then we can trade a bushel of beans for a bushel of corn and I'd have corn and beans, but that's all. So these people up in the mountains, and most of them didn't have 10 acres of corn, were starving to death. And these people were not going to die of COVID-19. They were going to die of starvation. And that is a very, very real statement. So Morgan and Coy and Peggy and I took on the project of collecting money and going out and buying huge bulk rice and beans. So every Monday, we would buy 10,000 pounds of rice and beans. And on Tuesday, we would put in 4-pound bags rice and beans. And on Wednesday, we would comb the mountainside going to houses. And on Thursday, we would go buy 10,000 pounds of rice and beans. And on Friday, we would put it in bags. And on Saturday, we would distribute. And we did it week after week after week after week. We were feeding 600 families every single week. 600 families. And we, if I'm not lying, if I've seen this once, I've seen it 50 times. A mother will come up to us and she will grab the rice and beans in tears and says, I can feed my babies. I can feed my babies tonight. They're not going to go to bed hungry. Wow. Just to be part of that is just amazing. It's just amazing to me that I've had the opportunity to be part of that. COVID, when it got to the point to where we were spending about $10,000, $10,000 to $15,000 a month on rice and beans, when that support dried up, we couldn't go buy all the rice and beans. And so we couldn't be on the road. We couldn't buy rice and beans. We couldn't have church service. You couldn't have meetings. You couldn't do door-to-door. I mean, it was shut down. We said, well, we might as well go back. If I'm going to be quarantined, I'll be quarantined in Watertown. So the 1st of May, we came back, and we've been back ever since. Honduras has since opened up. The borders are back open. The transportation is back going. There's a lot less COVID there than there is here. And everything is getting back to normal more and more. The only thing that you have to do to be able to go to Honduras now is you have to go get a rapid test and have negative and take the rapid test with you with your airline ticket and say, I'm negative, and you can go in. There's no quarantine. There's nothing like that. And I believe that probably first or second quarter of next year, you probably won't even have to do that. So moving forward with Ignite Missions, we're very excited to be getting back to some sense of normalcy. We've never been in the United States for this long. It's crazy how if your heart is in another place where God has called you to do. You know, I love being here. I love coming and worshiping. And I shared with my men's group last Monday night, don't ever, ever take for granted what you have in this auditorium. Don't ever. Because there may be a time in your life where you will not have the opportunity to have the fellowship of believers. For a few weeks, we couldn't have church, if you remember, and how wonderful it was to come back and to have the fellowship and to have the camaraderie of being here. So we're excited to go back, and we're going to go back, and we have some challenges ahead of us. What are we going to do? Well, we're going to get back, and we're going to have our teams. Our teams are on the schedule. Our teams are slated to come back. Do you have that slide, Peg? Oh. Teams just like that. We have a team that is going to be coming from this church or from this area, because I think there's probably some more people from another church that might come along. But our date for the team is June 28th through July 4th, 5th, somewhere around there. We have a very amazing team captain in Brad Whited right down here on the front row. There you go. There you go. And Brad came last year and on the team, and he is just a good friend of mine and a dear brother, and he is leading the team, so everything is going to be going through Brad, and we really don't know what that team is going to consist of. I mean, if you have women in the church who want to go and have a heartbeat for children, then we could have a vacation Bible school. We could have a women's ministry, you know, Miss Judy. We could have construction. We could do any and whatever the consistency of the team is. Guys love to build. Guys love to do. So, I mean, Coy loves to take men's groups and go out and to put roofs on houses. It's $200 to have a family have a roof where their house is dry for the first time in 15 years. So $200, you think, wow, that's a huge hand and feet of Jesus right there. So we're moving forward to have our teams. There's some needs that we have on the property. We, you know, like I said, we live on donations just like Water's Edge does. We need a water well. We have a beautiful property. We have all of these buildings. We have all of this stuff. And we need a well. And it costs $20,000. It's about 450 to 500 feet that we're going to have to dig down to hit the water table. So they charge by the foot. And it's very expensive to get a well. And so everyone says there's plenty of water. We just have to get it down there. So we need a well. We need a mode of transportation for all these teams that are coming down. We need a van. So, you know, it's going to cost us to find a decent used 15-passenger van. That's what we need. Peggy and I need a house. Not that we're homeless. We rent our house, and we, you know, we stay in a rented house, but we have to pay rent every single month. You know, and you think, well, it's cheap to live in Honduras. It is not cheap to live in Honduras. It costs to live in Honduras about what it costs to live here in Wilson County. So, and then we're also asking God for 50 people that will come alongside of us and say, listen, I believe in what you're doing. We can't do much, or we, you know, whatever. But we're looking for 50 people who will come along and say, I'll give $50 a month for you guys. You know, that's, you know, and that's not a crazy number. That's not a crazy number, but that's what we need. COVID has kicked us in the teeth with donations, just like it has churches, just like it has everybody's personal ministry. I get it. I am running out of time, but, you know, how can you help Ignite Missions? Number one, first and foremost, you can pray for us. You can pray for us. Pray for protection from our family. Pray for protection from our children that are here, because there's nothing that's going to bring Peggy and I out of the field than our family, our children, being in a crisis in the States. So pray for protection of our children. You can make donations, and you can partner with us through being a monthly donor. You know, that's the bottom line. And as I sang at the very, very beginning, He is faithful. God has been faithful for almost 20 years. We have never been in the red. God has provided every single month for us in the field. Can I hear an amen? God is faithful. We have some information at our ministry table out there. And if you would like to come out there, if you would like to get some information on supporting the ministry, all of that is out there. Just a heads up, because we're in Wilson County, we have a Christmas tree lot that we sell Christmas trees, and 100% of the funds, the proceeds, go to support Ignite Missions. 100% goes to the ministry. So it's going to be at Lester Farms on the corner of Coles Ferry and Hartman. And we have 400 beautiful Fraser fir trees. And so if you're interested in that information, that's in our table as well. Okay, I'm going to finish up with a song, and I'm turning it to CJ. The last thing I want to share with you is, not everybody in this room, not everybody is called to do what I'm called to do. It is a crazy ride. I'll be honest with you. It takes a partial psycho to do what we do. You didn't have to agree with that. But God called each and every one of us. Each one of us. If you're a student, if you're a stay-home mom, if you're a secretary, if you're a construction foreman, if you're a financial banker, whatever you are in your life, God has called each of us to be His hands and His feet. And you know, it is really, really easy for us here in Wilson County, beautiful Tennessee, to get so complacent and to get so comfortable. It's so easy to do that. But you know what? We have to get outside of this beautiful life that we have. And we have to go when God tells us to go. There could be somebody in here. that is the next leader of Ignite Missions. Easily. There could be somebody in here that is feeling that God is calling them into some sort of full-time ministry. Easily. I was a church member, plain Jane church member, and God called me to go do this. God wants each of us to step outside. And then I'm going to sing this song and turn it over to Pastor TJ.
In my own little world, it hardly ever rains. I've never gone hungry, always felt safe. I've got some money in my pocket and shoes on my feet. In my own little world, a population, me. Try to stay awake in Sunday morning church. Drop a 20 in the plate, but I never give till it hurts. And I turn off the news because I don't like what I see. In my own little world, a population, me. What if there's a bigger picture? What if I'm missing out? What if there's a greater purpose? I could be living right now outside my own little world. Pull at a stop sign, look out my window. Read a cardboard sign says, help this homeless widow. And just above the sign is a face of a human. And I tell myself, Lord, what have I been doing? So I roll down the window and I look her in the eyes. Oh, how many times have I just passed her by? Gave us some money and I drove on through. Now my own little world reached population two. Yeah. What if there's a bigger picture? What if I'm missing out? What if there's a greater purpose? I could be living right now outside my own little world. Father, break my heart for what breaks yours. God, give me open hands and open doors. And God, put your light in my eyes and help me see that my own little world is not about me. Yeah. What if there's a bigger picture? What if I'm missing out? What if there's a greater purpose? I could be living right now. Don't want to miss what matters. Want to be reaching out. Show me the greater purpose. I could be living right now outside my own little world. Ooh, my own little world. My own.
Thank you so much for your love, and thank you for allowing me to share.
Great job, man. Man, it's good stuff right there. Well, I want to thank you guys again for your faithfulness and giving. It allows us to be able to support our hometown missionary because you guys do such a good job of giving. As you leave, the offering is still in the back, so you can give that way, or you can actually give online through our website. We've actually jumped into the kind of do Venmo thing, so you could give that way as well. Also, please go by and see Sam and his wife and his family. They have a booth that's set up out there so you can learn more. Their Christmas trees are amazing, by the way. Okay, so we always go and get our Christmas tree from there, so we can't wait to do that and get set up there. Also, if you want to help us with the concession stand, please go see Miss Marie at the new here tent. And many of you guys know that we kind of shut down our children's ministry this week because we had just a little bit of some people with some contact tracing, some COVID, that type of thing. So we want to continue to pray, continue to ask God to protect us. He's done a great job of protecting us here in our congregation and our church. Okay, so I'm going to join us in prayer as we leave, and I pray and hope that you had a great day. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for who you are. We thank you that you are an awesome and amazing God. We thank you that we can be the hands and feet of Jesus just by giving, by praying, by going on mission trips. And we thank you that you brought Sam into our church family. We thank you for what he and his family bring to us. And we pray that you bless them. We pray for the country of Honduras as they try to overcome the hurricane and COVID and all the things that's going on down there. We pray for our country. We pray, Father God, for all the craziness that's going on right now, that people will turn to you who can be the calm in the midst of chaos. We thank you and praise you. Jesus' name I pray. Amen.